Lord, the parable says that the kingdom of heaven is like a marriage. And dear Lord, I can remember when I got married, and all of us here who are married can remember those days. They have for us our fondest hopes. They have for us the beginning of a love story that it's the beginning of a new day, a new work in the life, and it's about how much love is depicted as a marriage. And so, dear Lord, I know that your longing desire is to have us with you where you are. This is what you asked of the Father. And so, dear Lord, we're grateful this evening that you have met with us this week so far, and that I hope that it is our desire to be with you as strong as yours is to be with us. Bless Brother Pippinger, this little congregation this afternoon, that your spirit might be poured out in latter rain power. We ask thee for these things in Jesus' name, amen.
Okay, when you develop your presentations, you have to put the logic in place for your presentations, and I'm watching most of the things that seemed important to be put in place for the conclusions of my presentations that come later this week are already being dealt with by the brethren here and the sisters, which is good. Repetition is good. But I can't stray from my notes because someone might just purchase afterwards my presentations. I can't count that they're going to watch the other presentations, but it also makes it a little bit, puts a restraint on you. But discussing some of the things I've been seeing going on here, because what I'm doing in my first handful of presentations is just building a platform for the conclusion that I'm going to deal with. I like what Sister Heather was showing us. I want to remind us, probably many of us are familiar with this, that one of the things that is shaking this movement right now is the idea that from 9/11 until the Sunday law, there is an internal work that's supposed to take place among God's people within and among themselves. And the primary argument is the character of Christ that upholds this, because the character of Christ in the first chapter of Revelation is emphasized that he is the beginning and the ending, the first and the last, and the Alpha and the Omega. And through a correct study of all his prophecies, he always illustrates the end of a prophecy with the beginning of a prophecy. So up here, you have the beginning of ancient Israel, and here you have the end of ancient Israel. And although her line doesn't extend out here to the 40 years, we know that in this history, for the first 40 years, there was a work that took place internally among ancient Israel that preceded them being taken into the Promised Land and conquering Jericho and all the land thereafter, which Sister White tells us the conquering of Jericho is a symbol of carrying the gospel message to the world. And at the end of ancient Israel, there was an internal work that went on for the Jews for a period of 7 years, 2,520 prophetic days, in the middle of which you find the cross, and therefore the cross is the center of the subject of the 2520. But if you would extend this out here to the stoning of Stephen in AD 34, you find that at the end of ancient Israel, there was an internal work that was carried out for the disciples before they took the gospel to the Gentiles after AD 34. And what Sister Heather put in place for us, among other things, if you did not recognize it, is that the history of Adventism is crystal clear that from 1844 to the 1850 time period, this was an internal work that went on among the Adventists in advance of the Lord leading them into public evangelism. Therefore, if Jesus illustrated the end of ancient Israel with the beginning of ancient Israel, and ancient Israel is the primary symbol of modern Israel and the beginning of modern Israel, in all three of these witnesses, there is an internal work that takes place among the chosen people that the Lord is entering into covenant with, then you would assume, if you understand the character of Christ, that when he's entering into covenant with those that we call the 144,000 at the end of modern Israel, that there would be an internal work that takes place in advance of the public evangelism that we call the loud cry of the third angel. And of course, without detracting from her lines, I'd say that 9/11 is right here where this angel comes down and marks the beginning of the internal work for us that is carried out until Pentecost, which is one of the primary symbols of the Sunday law. And therefore, what she was saying is some very important information that is currently shaking those in this movement. Brother Theodore, at one point, showed us something here this week, and I had a sister ask me a question that I'm going to try to get to, but I don't know if I'll get to it because we don't know where we're going right yet, all right? Brother Theodore shared that in Isaiah 7, there is a prophecy set forth. And Isaiah 7 is one of the places in the Bible where you can date that passage more conclusively than several other passages in the Bible, because in Isaiah 7, you don't simply have one king referenced, you have three kings referenced. Therefore, you have three sound historical witnesses that allows the chronologist, like Brother Theodore, to go back in and lock it in. And Isaiah 7 begins in the year 742, and in Isaiah 7, you find a 65-year time prophecy, which the Millerites identify as the starting of both 25-20 scattering prophecies. The prophecy says within 65 years. It doesn't say in 65 years. It says within 65 years, the northern kingdom would be carried away. And we know that the northern kingdom was carried into captivity in the year 723. And when you extend this 65 years out, you come to the year 677. When Manasseh was carried into captivity, and those theologians in Adventism that are fighting the fact that both this northern, that any, but the northern and southern kingdom both had 25-20 time prophecies associated with them, will tell you that if there was going to be a 2520-year time prophecy, a 2520-year scattering of the southern kingdom, it's invalid to place it in the time of Manasseh, because when he was carried to Babylon, he thereafter repented and returned, okay? So they say it's not valid, but what they do not understand when they say that is that Jesus illustrates the end from the beginning, okay? And Manasseh is the first of the last seven kings. I don't really know how to say that, but if you go from Manasseh, and I'll look at my notes, I won't pretend that I know these. The next king for Judah I'm talking about is Ammon, Josiah, Jehoahaz, Jehoiakim, Jehoiachin, Zedekiah. So if you start the 2520 against the northern kingdom, it brings you down here to 1798. 2520 years that the northern kingdom of Israel was scattered. And in Daniel 8, we're told that Christ is Palmoni, the wonderful number. So brothers and sisters, it's absolutely ridiculous to think that it would be just a coincidence that the dead center of this 2520 years is 538. Because according to Gerhard Damsteed, who Brother DeWayne has been referencing, the primary approach to Bible prophecy that was adopted by William Miller, and you can find it on page 22 of his book, was that Miller saw two desolating powers in prophecy. Paganism, the desolating power outside God's church, and papalism, the desolating power inside God's church. And when you understand this 2520 against Israel begins in 723 BC and ends in 1798, what you have done is identified 1260 years that paganism tramples down God's people, followed by 1260 years that, did I say papalism? No. That papalism tramples down God's people. So there's, in this 2520 prophecy against the Northern Kingdom, there's many things going on. But in this 2520, there's something different going on, okay? Because Jesus illustrates the end from the beginning, and Manasseh carried into captivity, and Brother Theodore mentioned a little bit of this. This takes place. He is the king of the southern kingdom. And what's the southern kingdom? Judah. And how many kingdoms are there in the southern kingdom? Two. And what, in the terms of Daniel 11, 40 to 45, would you call Judah? Hey, you guys are jumping ahead. What would you call it? In the terminology of Daniel 11, 40 to 45, what would you call it? The glorious land. Okay? See, Manasseh is the king of the glorious land, a two-horned power, okay? And Sister White, as Brother Theodore correctly pointed out, says that Manasseh was an earnest of what was to come. And if you look in the dictionary of Ellen White's Day and Age, earnest means down payment, okay? So Manasseh represents a progressive fall. All right. He's carried to Babylon. That's the down payment, saying this is what's happening. You're going to get carried into captivity, but it's going to be a progressive destruction that is carried out against seven kings. So when you get to the conclusion of this time prophecy of 2520 years, you're not seeing the story of 1260 years of paganism trampling down God's people, followed by 1260 years of papalism trampling down God's people. You're seeing the story of the glorious land right down here. And the glorious land becomes the sixth kingdom of Bible prophecy. When? Why? Okay, that's when the world recognized the United States as a legitimate sovereign nation with 1798. It's also when the papacy received the deadly wound. So this 2520-year prophecy is coming right down into the United States, and it's, what's it predicting? How can you answer that? Well, it's predicting down here what's illustrated at the beginning. It's predicting a progressive fall of the spiritual glorious land, the United States of America, which is also a two-horned power that has been typified back here by Benjamin and Judah. And in 1798 to 1844, this is the reform lines we've been looking at, you have the story of the Seven Thunders. And those Seven Thunders have been typified by these seven kings. And these seven kings are talking about a progressive fall of the two-horned power of the glorious land. And what was the first horn of the glorious land to fall? Because there are two horns. What are the two horns of the United States in Bible prophecy? Protestantism and Republicanism. Which one gets conquered first? When? There you go. Now we're getting more specific. We used to say 1842, then we had some light, and we might say 1844, but now we know it was April 19th, 1844. The second angel message came down and said, Babylon is fallen. The Protestants of the United States had returned to Rome. What do I mean by return to Rome? They had been protesting against Rome. They were given opportunity to break away from Rome with the first angel's message. But when they rejected the first angel's message, they determined to carry the doctrines and the philosophy of the papacy. That's getting into Revelation 17. But right here, the first horn of Protestantism is conquered. But what we're saying is, this history from 1798 to 1844, it's repeated down here at the end of the world from 1989 to the Sunday Law. Because the second horn of the glorious land needs to be conquered. So we're saying 1798 to 1844 is the seven thunders, and 1989 to the Sunday Law is the seven thunders. Therefore, when does the second horn, the political aspect of the United States, get conquered? You have to let me ask the question before you answer, all right? Particularly if you have the wrong answer. When does the second horn get conquered? Brothers and sisters, if the first horn got conquered right here on April 19th, 1844, when the Protestants rejected the first angel's message, what does April 19th, 1844 identify? The tarrying time. When does the tarrying time start in our history? 9/11. 9/11, brothers and sisters. Now, some of you know this, but you haven't maybe internalized what you know. Some of you here know very well that Islam was restrained on 9/11, and that this is represented as Revelation 7, when the four winds are held in check. Okay, and what happens when the four winds are held in check in Revelation 7? The sealing of God's people begins. It's underway, okay? So when are they going to receive the seal of God? At the Sunday Law. So there's a period of time just before the Sunday Law where the Lord holds back the persecution that's coming down the pike, but the United States already conquered. Okay? That's illustrated in Millerite history. It's conquered at 9/11. The implementation, the reality of that conquering is the Sunday Law. But brothers and sisters, what's the symbol of the United States' strength? And brothers and sisters, the strength of the United States is the subject of Bible prophecy. Rome's, the Constitution, has been symbolized by the symbol of Rome's strength. The symbol of Rome's strength is the subject of the book of Daniel, and pagan Rome typifies the United States. So the United States has a strength, and the strength of the United States is the Sunday Law, or is the Constitution, which is fully overturned at the Sunday Law. So how does 9/11 represent that it's conquered? What happened at 9/11? The Patriot Act, brothers and sisters, it's already conquered. You've already changed to Roman law. The four angels are just holding back what's coming down the pike, waiting for you and I to prepare character for the seal of God. Okay, so, but what that's not really the where I want to go. I just want you to see that from 1798 to 1844, you're seeing the beginning of the progressive fall of the United States, and it's been typified by the beginning of this prophecy, the 2520. And brothers and sisters, if you don't believe in the 2520, you can't see what's happening in the United States right now. You're closing your eyes. Because Millerite history is repeated in our history. And in our history, this is where the second horn gets conquered. And it's all typified back here with Manasseh. Now, if you go to your notes at this point, page 157, as God has given the messages of Revelation 14 their place in the line of prophecy, and their work is not to cease till the close of this earth's history. The first and second angels' messages are still truth for this time and are to run parallel with that which follows. The first angel's message, it has been established here this week, arrived in 1798. All the messages arrive at a certain point in time, and they're thereafter empowered. The second angel's message arrived when? God, we're in the Millerite history, my brother. The second angel's message arrived here, April 19th, 1844. Where does the third angel's message arrive? 10/22/1844. So Sister White says the first and second angel's message are truth for this time. She doesn't say the first, second, and third, and are to run parallel with this which follows. What follows the first and second angel's message? The third. So there, the history of the third angel is going to parallel the history of the first and second. Okay? And this, brothers and sisters, what we're the point we're making here, I'm trying to make this point for a sister that does the transcriptions for these audio presentations. And so she asked me that some of these concepts are a bit hard for her to follow when it comes to the point in the transcriptions where she makes these illustrations in the books that she's preparing. So the question was a good one, and you may not think this is important, but when you teach these reform lines like this, this is something that a student has to get. And now you're saying, well, what do you have to get? Okay, you have to get certain things about the three messages, all right? Number one, sometimes Sister White says these messages represent Jesus Christ. Okay, so you can look at these. When she says the angel that came down out of heaven on August 11th, 1840 is no less a personage than Jesus Christ, or she says that the Protestants in the Millerite history crucified these three messages as certainly as the Jews crucified Christ, then she's comparing all three of those messages to Christ. Okay, so, and I've had people when you read that to them say, what do you mean that Christ actually left the heavenly sanctuary on August 11th, 1840, and came down to earth. And so you have to grapple to make these distinctions, and it's not that easy because Sister Wright repeatedly says that these angels represent the work that God's people are to do. Okay, so figures have different, more than one meaning. Rule number 10, right? So you have to grapple with the reality that these angels are symbolizing a sacred work where divinity flashes through humanity. And you're to understand that this work is so sacred that if you reject this work, you are crucifying Christ. That's how sacred it is. But you must understand that Christ accomplishes this work through human beings, okay? And that these waymarks that are marked by these angels are marking points where a special or specific work is carried out. Okay, but now, 1798, the book of Daniel is unsealed, the first angel's message arrives. There's an increase of knowledge that's going to test this generation. And this increase of knowledge goes through history until it's formalized, and then it's empowered every time. These are always the same. This is the empowerment of the first. This is the arrival of the second. That's why it's 2A. The midnight cry is the empowerment of the second. Second and the third arrives here. Okay, so let me go back here now to the notes. The unsealing, okay? Page 157. It was the Lion of the tribe of Judah who unsealed the book and gave to John the revelation of what should be in the last days. The unsealing of this message that will test this generation is accomplished by Jesus Christ, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Daniel stood in his lot to bear his testimony, which was sealed unto the time of the end when the first angel's message should be proclaimed to our world. So at this point, when he unseals this truth, the first angel's message arrives, then it's formalized and it begins to go through history. Okay, so when we draw the parallel up here of 1989, the unsealing, the formalization, since 1996, the message that was unsealed began to go through history, and then it was empowered on 9/11, what angel came down on 9/11?
18.
That's the best answer, all right? Why is this the fourth angel? Does Revelation 18 say the fourth angel came down out of heaven? Okay, so this is the concept the sister's grappling with in terms of illustrating this. This message it's going through here, this is the third angel's message. The first and second angel's message are still truth for this time, and they're to run parallel with that which follows. So this was the first angel's message going through history. This has to be the third angel's message going through history. But we've been teaching you that at 9/11, what angel came down? The first and the second. Or if you're going to use the terminology of Revelation 18 that we often use, it's the fourth, okay? Do you follow what we've been teaching here?
Yeah.
That this history, this was the first angel getting empowered here when Islam's restrained, and when Islam was restrained on 9/11, the angel that came down has already been represented by the empowerment of the first angel. So this angel that comes down at the restraint of Islam is the empowerment of the first message. I thought we just said this was the third. We did, but this is the first angel in our history, but it is the third angel. Okay, but if you're going to call Revelation 18 the fourth angel, you got to recognize that there's two angels that come down here, because the second angel that came down here also comes down here, all right? So what I'm saying, I'm not trying to confuse you. I might be doing a good job, but I'm letting you know that you have the responsibility to get these things right, and they're not really that hard. If you don't let them overwhelm you, they're not really that hard. This is the beginning of Adventism. This is the end of Adventism. This is the time period of the first angel's message. And the first angel's message was fear God and give him glory, for the hour of his judgment is come. The first and second angel's message are followed by the third. The third angel's message is a warning against receive the mark of the beast. If you receive the mark of the beast, you're going to be on the wrong side of the issue when probation closes and Michael stands up. Okay? So this is the history of the third angel. This is the history of the first angel. But when you're looking at these angels as symbols of the work that is accomplished in these histories, then you need to be careful to make a distinction that that's what's being represented. And if you're looking at the fact that people are rejecting these messages, then these angels represent Christ. Okay, so you just, by the context, you have to define the figures, and figures have more than one meaning. So it's the line of the tribe of Judah that unseals these truths in each of these histories. Notice from James White under Pioneer Position. When did he write this? 1853. Sister Heather, do you think that he still has this endorsement in 1853 that he was writing under the power of the Holy Spirit? I don't know. He says, what Daniel was commanded to seal up and close is now, through the all-powerful mediation of the line of the tribe of Judah, revealed unto us. Revelation 5:5. Hence, many run to and fro, and knowledge is increased. So what I'm saying is, the unsealing that takes place at the time of the end, as illustrated to us in Daniel chapter 12, the complement of that is Revelation 5. The book of Daniel is unsealed at the time of the end in 1798. It's unsealed with the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1989. But Revelation 5 tells us the person or the God that unseals it to us is Christ, represented by the line of the tribe of Judah. They're parallel lines of prophecy. Okay, so this history here, the reason that I'm relating to it right here is the seven thunders. It's because right now there are men that used to teach these things that are saying these patterns, that we've made them above the Bible, that they're not salvational, and that you should only accept the patterns if they agree with the Bible. Brothers and sisters, if you want to say you should only accept the pattern when they agree with the Bible, if you want to be honest in that criticism, what you should say is, here's where you are disagreeing with the Bible when you present the pattern that way. If there's disagreements about these lines, go ahead and show us from the Word of God why they're wrong. But don't just cast doubt out there to the community saying, we'll only accept these patterns when they agree with the Bible. Just show us where they disagree with the Bible so we can correct our errors. Okay? See, it may be Miller's argument, but where this argument began was in heaven. Okay? It's casting doubt without taking upon yourself the responsibility of demonstrating why the patterns that are being presented are incorrect. Okay? And it's, brothers and sisters, it's directed at the messengers of the patterns. And these guys don't understand that these angels represent Jesus Christ. And the messengers that are doing the work represented by these angels are just doing the work that was given to them. And when you're attacking those messengers, you're attacking the lion of the tribe of Judah. Okay, so Sister White tells us, now you know, some of you know, some of you don't know. Just a few of you in here don't know, I realize that. But my sympathies lie, my empathy lies you gotta be part of this congregation and know what that means. Lies with those of us in here that are very new to this experience, okay? Go to Revelation 10. This is old review for some of you. You know, we had a shaking. Wherever you are from, and there's different countries and different states represented here, and some of you have had shaking over this teaching about public evangelism, but the first shaking we saw over it was right here in this little church. Okay. This is pretty much where it started, okay? And there was a group of people that are no longer here. And it's tragic and it's sad. And what was I going to say? Why was I saying? Oh, and in that, as we labored to try to make that not happen, we realize, and this is, does it just didn't happen here, it's happening all over the place, is that, brothers and sisters, if the guy that you think is so wonderful is wrong, and he's been exposed as being wrong, let him suffer the consequences of being wrong, according to inspiration. Don't sympathize with the idea that the man that has demonstrated that he is wrong doesn't have the correct Christian demeanor to address him. Because Sister White's crystal clear, when you sympathize with the evildoers, you about close the door on the possibility for them to turn around and repent. The best thing to do is just let them suffer under a public rebuke so they might be driven to the foot of the cross. That didn't go on here. There was a lot of sympathy in this little group, and there's a lot of sympathy in this message that's preventing the guys that you love the most from having the possibility to turn around and repent, and you become partaker of their error, and you will receive of their judgment if you do that. So in the midst of that, we got to a point where we understood we don't want to sympathize with someone that's having a problem, but it's okay to empathize. That's why I said that earlier, all right? Even though there are passages in the spirit of prophecy where it's okay to sympathize.
She calls them false sympathizers.
False sympathy. We don't want no false sympathy. So in Revelation 10, for those of you that are new, this mighty angel of Revelation 10 came down when Islam was restrained in Revelation 10, verses 1 and 2. And then in verse 3, it says, and cried with a loud voice as when a lion roareth. And I'm telling you that when a lion roareth, it's no other person than the lion of the tribe of Judah in chapter 5. Okay, this is the same lion. It's Christ. He roars. And when he had cried, seven thunders uttered their voices. And when seven thunders had uttered their voices, I was about to write, and I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, seal up those things which the seven thunders uttered, and write them not. Now, brothers and sisters, the only thing that's sealed up in the book of Revelation is what the seven thunders uttered. Okay, that's it. Pardon me? I heard something. Oh, okay. It's all right. So in the book of Revelation, whatever the seven thunders represent, they are sealed up. Now notice this in page 157. This is Sister White. She's going to tell us about these seven thunders. She says, the mighty angel under the seven thunders, the mighty angel who instructed John was no less a personage than Jesus Christ. Setting his right foot upon the sea and his left foot upon dry land shows the part which he is acting in the closing scenes of the great controversy with Satan. I didn't read verses 1 and 2 of Revelation 10, but when this mighty angel comes down, he puts one foot upon the sea and one foot upon the earth. She's commenting on him. She says he's no less a personage than Jesus Christ. This position denotes his supreme power and an authority over the whole earth. Drop down to the next paragraph. After these seven thunders uttered their voices, the injunction. What's an injunction? It's a command. Okay, if you're building a house and you don't have the permits, the city will come out and give you an injunction to stop building. Okay, it's a command. It's a legal command. The injunction comes to John as to Daniel in regard to the little book. So please notice, it is Sister White that is comparing this sealing up of the seven thunders with the sealing up of the book of Daniel. All right? It's her that's making this comparison. After these seven thunders uttered their voices, the injunction comes to John as to the Daniel in regard to the little book, seal up those things which the seven thunders uttered and write them not. Seven thunders uttered. These relate to future events which will be disclosed in their order. So what do the seven thunders represent? Future events that will be disclosed in their order. Okay, so when did Sister White write this? I think it's 1895. It's future to the 1890s. Sometimes I have it noted in my notes. I don't this time. So she... 1900, okay. So she's saying the seven thunders represent future events that will be disclosed in their orders, but here's, if you haven't ever seen a contradiction in Sister White's writings, let me give you one. In the same passage, in the next paragraph, she says, the special light given to John, which was expressed in the seven thunders, was a delineation of events which would transpire under the first and second angels' messages. Wow. Sister White says the seven thunders are a delineation of events that took place under the first and second angels' message. That's this history of the Millerites. But she also says it represents future events that will be disclosed in their orders. It's not a contradiction. Well, what is it? Revelation 22, verse 10. Now read verse 11 first. This, every one of us knows what verse 11 is typically as Adventists. It says, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still, and he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. When does this take place, brothers and sisters? When Michael stands up. The books of Daniel and Revelation are the same book. When Michael's standing up, this is what he's saying as he stands up. This is the close of human probation. And just before the close of human probation, what does verse 10 say? It says, and he saith unto me, seal not the sayings of the prophecy of this book, for the time is at hand. There comes a time just before human probation closes when the Lion of the tribe of Judah is going to unseal the seven thunders. And when he does, the unsealing of the seven thunders parallels the unsealing of the book of Daniel in 1798. And when the book of Daniel was unsealed in 1798, the increase of knowledge that took place at that time tested that generation. What was the increase of knowledge in 1798? Daniel 8. The hour of his judgment is to come. They were going to be tested by the message that Jesus was returning to the earth to in flaming vengeance and fire to destroy the wicked. That's how it was portrayed to them. They were going to be tested by that message. When this seven thunders is unsealed in 1989, what is our generation going to be tested about? They're saying Daniel 11. Anyone got a better shot? Brothers and sisters, what was unsealed? What's the seven thunders? It's the truth that the Millerite history is repeated to the very letter in our history. It's the line upon lines. It's the latter rain. The latter rain message of line upon line is going to test this generation. So when you're at the point in time where people are making fun of the patterns publicly, whoa, they're not only attacking Christ, they're rejecting the Holy Spirit. The outpouring of the latter rain. Okay, so I'm just wanting you to see that I don't know how much more serious it can be. So, God is not redundant. What do I mean by that? I mean that when he teaches one line, such as here with the Millerite history, and he's already taught a similar lesson at the beginning of ancient Israel and the end of ancient Israel, he may repeat waymarks along the way so we have the ability to line them up. But he teaches lessons in here that complement the lessons in here, that complement these lessons. He's not redundant. He doesn't just portray another line where there's nothing new to build upon. Do you follow what I'm saying? The seven thunders, Sister White says, represents what? Whatever it is, in either history, she says events. She says it represents a delineation. And in the dictionary of Ellen White's day and age, what does delineation mean? To set forth upon a line, to trace or draw. A delineation of events that would transpire under the first and second angel's messages. And then when she also, she doesn't contradict herself, but when she says it relates to future events, she's telling us that the seven thunders represent the events of these two sacred histories. Okay? Whereas, where we're going next is the parable of the ten virgins that was fulfilled in this history to the very letter and will be fulfilled in this history to the very letter. It's the same identical teaching, except one is the seven thunders and one is the parable of the ten virgins. The seven thunders is emphasizing the events. What does the parable of the ten virgins represent? They experience. Great Controversy 393, the parable of the ten virgins of Matthew 25 represents the experience of the Adventist people. So the line of the parable of the ten virgins up here, it's emphasizing a different thought than the events. Okay, the events are going to be there. Okay, in fact, the parable of the ten virgins, when it comes to Ezra 7:9, it places some emphasis on the events that are just profound, right? 120 days, 70 days. But it's talking about the experience that we go through in that history. So, what I'm saying is, the seven thunders took place in this history. They take place in this history, right? And their events. But this history here is what? You can't really know what answer I'm looking for. Right? It's the end of these two 2520 time prophecies. This 2520 ends in 1798, and this one ends in 1844. Okay? So what does this one teach us about this history? It's talking about a progress. The seven thunders is bringing the lesson home to us of events, but the seven last kings, which line up with the seven thunders, what's it teaching? A progressive fall of the glorious land. All right. Was there a progressive fall of the glorious land in this history? The second angel's message, Sister White says, the Protestants suffered a moral fall, but that fall was not complete. It was progressive. The fall of Babylon isn't complete in Protestant America till down here at the Sunday law. Okay? You follow my point? The seven kings are a second witness to the seven thunders. All right. But the seven kings, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Those are the seven kings. So I'm telling you that my primary understanding, I'm open for correction on this, but I know this, it's at least true, if it's not the primary truth. These seven kings bring us to the history of the seven thunders. Okay. If it was six kings that came to the history of the seven thunders, you couldn't put it together. But if it's seven kings that leads you to the history of the seven thunders, you gotta put it together. Okay. Student of Prophecy's gotta put it together. The seven thunders is about the events of this history, the seven kings, the progressive fall of the glorious land. Okay? There's a lot more in there because you got the 2520. What's that bringing? It's bringing the message of the scattering and the gathering of the fourth generation. Okay, this is just an overview, so there's a lot more. But who's the first king here? Okay, go to page 158. I'm just going to put M for Manasseh, okay? Rather than spell out the names of all these kings. But what does his name mean? Causing to forget. Okay, and he's followed by Ammon. A for Ammon. You know, you can, and which means to build or support. There's even one place, if you look up Ammon, it means architect, okay, which is okay. Because in this history, the message of the Millerite is being built up by William Miller. He's the architect. The Lord's the architect, but he's using William Miller to build up this message. Right? You follow me? And what does William Miller do? He Josiah's. What does Josiah mean? Foundation. Okay, he's the one that is employed to put the foundational truths on this chart together by the Lord. And then you come to Jehoahaz. Now, I want you to know something here about Jehoahaz and Jehoiakim. History kind of ties them together. Anyone know why? Yeah, because the king of Egypt comes in and he takes Jehoahaz captive and replaces him with Jehoiakim. Okay, so in the history, there's a connection between them. So what does Jehoahaz mean? The Lord seized, okay? If I seize you, Sister Kathy? Okay, if I seize you, Brother David, or Sister David, am I putting a restraint upon you? Okay, see, Jehoahaz is talking about a restraint that takes place here. What's Jehoiakim? To rise. Right here, the Lord comes down out of heaven and rises up. He stands with one foot upon the earth and one foot upon the sea. Right here where Jehoahaz is seized, put a restraint on him. What was restrained when the Lord stood upon the earth? Islam. What's the next king? Jehoiachin. What's that mean? To erect, okay, and to tarry. This is the tarrying time. What happens at the tarrying time? The temple gets erected. Following the logic? Which leads us to Zedekiah. What's that mean? But when we talk about cleansed, Zedekiah, there wasn't anything clean about Zedekiah. What do we glean from cleansed? It's the same word that's translated unto 2300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. Okay, right here is the Daniel 8:14. Right here with Jehoiachin is the tarrying time. Right here with this rising up of Jehoiakim is when the angel came down on August 11th, 1840, when Islam was seized, it was restrained. Right after, William Miller puts the foundational truths in place, which was followed by, preceded by Ammon and Manasseh. Do you see that? You think that's an accident? There is no accidents in the Word of God. Okay, so this history, these kings here, are representing a progressive fall that takes place in the Millerite history from 1798 to 1844. To me, more than anything else, the seven kings are the progressive fall of the U.S. United States, the glorious land, the two-horned power. But at a secondary level, the names of these kings tie together the parable of the ten virgins, Ezra 7:9, and the history of the Millerites with their names. Okay, because the tarrying time, the fact that Jehoahaz means the tarrying time, that ties Ezra 7:9 and the parable of the ten virgins into the waymark right before Zedekiah marks the waymark of the cleansing of the sanctuary. You following me? Okay, but what does Jesus do? He illustrates the end from the beginning. So when it comes to the quote that we started with, the first and second angel's message are still truth for this time, are to run parallel with that which follows. In our history, the second horn of the United States is going to be conquered. And in our history, these seven kings are going to be repeated from 1989 to the Sunday Law. You follow the logic? Okay. In 1989, in 1798, you know the papacy was forgotten, right?
Yep.
According to Isaiah, the papacy would be forgotten for 70 years as the days of one king. The papacy's forgotten from 1798 until the Sunday Law, the days of one king, the one king being the kingdom of the United States. Okay? How many are familiar with that passage in Isaiah 23? Okay. So Manasseh's marking when the papacy is going to be forgotten in 1798. What happened in 1989? I'll tell you what happened, brothers and sisters. Sister White says, all those that become confused on the meaning of Antichrist will ultimately end up on the side of Antichrist. And Ronald Reagan said that the reason that he was willing to enter into an alliance with the man of sin to bring down the Soviet Union was because Ronald Reagan had come to understand, Ronald Reagan being a professing Christian, and every Christian church used to know that the Antichrist of Bible prophecy was the Pope of Rome, but Ronald Reagan had come to understand and believe that the Soviet Union was the Antichrist. And because of that, according to Ronald Reagan, he was willing to enter into a secret alliance with the man of sin. All those that become confused on the meaning of Antichrist will ultimately end up on the side of Antichrist. He forgot, as a Protestant Christian, who the man of sin was. And he entered into a secret alliance with the man of sin to bring down the Soviet Union, and Manasseh, the papacy, was forgotten in 1989 as the seven thunders and the seven kings and the parable of the ten virgins began to repeat. You follow? Okay. All right. Are you with me?
Amen.
Okay, so it repeats in our history, okay? And it'd be nice if it was right fresh in our mind, but I watched during Heather's presentation, there were some people I don't know well enough that were nodding off, so I wasn't going to say anything. Some of you know that if I know you well enough and I watch you falling asleep, I might say something, but I wasn't going to do it in Heather's presentation to people I don't know that well. But I know it's been a long 3 days and it's the end of the day. So even those of us that aren't sleepy probably can't remember some of the concepts that she was sharing, But if you did, if you could remember those concepts and take it one step further than what she was saying. She read several passages, brothers and sisters, where she says the men in the Millerite history that were used of the Lord to accomplish this work, they're the ones you can place your confidence in. Okay. You remember those quotes? Do you believe that this history is repeated in this history? Do you? Has there been men used in this history in the same period of time? See, those quotes, see, Ellen White's a prophet. The prophets are speaking more about the end of the world than the days in which she lived, they lived, in which Ellen White lived. Therefore, she's telling you, if you will hear it, that the men that were used in this history, the ones that had the experience of this history, they have an endorsement of the Lord that these guys that came on later don't possess because they don't have that experience. All right? So you follow my point? So in this history here, the Lord was going to build. He was going to start, he's going to raise up some architecture to put together the foundation, Ammon, Josiah. But on 9/11, Jehoahaz was going to be restrained. This earthly power was going to be seized once again. There was going to be a restraint placed upon him. And at that time, the Lord was going to arise and shake terribly the earth when the great buildings of New York City were thrown down and Revelation 18, verses 1 through 3 were fulfilled. Okay? That's these kings. What's the next king? Jehoiachin. Okay, but we know that in our history, what do we have to do? We have to combine them. So you got to bring in our history here, you got to bring Jehoiachin back here to 9/11. This guy here to the tarrying time. And what do you do when you bring in Ezra 7:9? You develop this leading to the midnight cry. That leads to what? No, it doesn't. What's it lead to? Zedekiah. It leads to Zedekiah, all right? The perfect. Now, brothers and sisters, we've taught here. It isn't that common. I don't know if that you have studied it, if you haven't come across a DVD, but it's been taught in this congregation more than once. And it's sound. Was the sanctuary cleansed on October 22nd, 1844? No. Okay. It just wasn't. Brother said, you think that the sanctuary in heaven has been cleansed already? That's when the beginning of the cleansing took place, brothers and sisters. Sister White tells us that the perfect fulfillment of the second angel's message is still future. The perfect fulfillment of the second angel's message takes place in this history. Therefore, the second angel's message of the Millerite history was imperfect. And Sister White says you can't have a third without a first and a second. So if the second angel's message was imperfect in that history, then the third was imperfect and the first was imperfect. This is imperfect in the sense that it's typifying the point in time when the sanctuary is cleansed. Because brothers and sisters, when the sanctuary is cleansed, sinners no more enter the sanctuary forever. Okay? The blotting out of sin is where the cleansing of the sanctuary meets its perfect fulfillment in our history. Zedekiah is pointing forward to the time when the sanctuary is perfectly cleansed. And when it's perfectly cleansed, the Lord's going to take a first fruit offering into it that he's taken out of Adventism, and he's going to lift them up as an ensign. Do you think any of those 11th hour workers are going to come and stand with God's people in the Sunday law crisis and possess a sin and repent experience? No way, brothers and sisters. At the Sunday law, the church changes to the church triumphant. It's no longer the church militant. The perfect fulfillment of Zedekiah is the Sunday law. This is the perfect fulfillment of Daniel 8:14. Okay? You with me? No? Okay. Bottom of page 158. The parable of the 10 virgins was given by Christ himself, and every specification should be carefully studied. A time will come when the door will be shut. I want to put this in the record here. They're on the top of page 159. Sister White will identify five Can I erase this? It's recorded. Okay, I won't. Sister White talks about at least five waymarks in the parable of the 10 virgins. We just read a quote where she says, every specification should be carefully studied. She placed her emphasis upon the closing of the door. That would be right down here for us, as it was for the Millerites. What's the waymark that precedes the closing of the door? The midnight cry. What's the waymark that precedes that? The tarrying time. Okay, so in the box on page 159, she says the coming of Christ as announced by the first angel was understood to be represented as the coming of the bridegroom. When did the first angel arrive? Down here. Okay, so there's a waymark that's a parable in the 10 virgins. And the widespread reformation under the proclamation of his soon coming answered to the going forth of the virgins. When did the widespread reformation take place? In the Millerite history. I would submit that it's when the angel came down. Brothers and sisters, there's a place where she said when the Ottoman, she doesn't say it this way, but when the Ottoman Empire collapsed, there's a place where she says, I hope I'm not exaggerating, but it seems like 50,000 infidels, she uses the word infidels, joined the movement. Okay, so here's a widespread reformation that comes about because of the message of Islam. All right. Yep. You follow me? And then you have the midnight cry, the tarrying time, which would be here, the midnight cry, and the door closed. There's the five waymarks in the parable of the 10 virgins. And these waymarks in this line, which this is the line of the parable of the 10 virgins, they have a second witness that we've been laying over the top. Is there not? What's that second witness that we've been laying over the top? Ezra 7:9. Okay. So, bottom of page 159. I'm about out of time, right? All right. So, anyway, let me pull this together, because this was preparatory to following presentations. I can live with the fact that I didn't follow my notes. The seven thunders was unsealed just before probation closes. It represents the principle that Jesus illustrates the end from the beginning, but it primarily emphasizes that the beginning and ending that are repeated is the beginning of Adventism in the Millerite movement and the ending of Adventism in our day and age. In connection with this truth, you have the parable of the 10 virgins. That is another line that lays right over the top, but it's emphasizing not the events, it's emphasizing the experience. As a second witness to the seven thunders, you have the seven kings, which brings the light of the 2520s into this. But all we're speaking about is the fact that these seven kings identifying the progressive fall of the United States, that the first horn is conquered in the Millerite history, the second horn is conquered in our history, also contributes secondary witness to these waymarks that is encompassed with the meaning of the names of these kings. Okay. This here, that much information right here, if we wanted to, we could quit studying anything else and we could just work from that point of reference the rest of the week, okay? There's so much light in this principle of the seven thunders that it confirms that that's what the line of tribe of Judah unsealed at this point in time, is the line upon line latter rain message, okay? The idea that people are rejecting that is, that kind of rejection is not human, okay? That kind of rejection is supernatural. So I put that in place for, I still have some more things to put in place tomorrow, but for the purpose of focusing in on the significance of the tarrying time and what's taking place at this point in Earth's history. Shall we pray? Father in heaven, it's been wonderful to hear the things that you've been sharing with us throughout this day. It's been a blessing to have such a peaceful time here for the first 3 days of this camp meeting. We need to go home and get some rest this evening. We ask that you take us home safely and that you'd provide that rest. We want to continue through this week in a positive way, that you can continue to speak to our hearts and our minds. But Lord, we want to make this week a point in our experience where we know that you've changed us more fully in your image, that you've consecrated us, that you've helped us see the importance of surrendering ourself into your hands, that you might finish this work. Please do whatever it takes for each of us to make that a reality in our life. Help us understand that the times that we are in, the hard times, the tragic time, the painful times, is designed to make the jewels shine brighter in the coming contest. Give us the patience that we need to stand in this time and glorify you. And we thank you for these things. In Jesus' name, amen.